Good evening, everyone. We have the Chief Executive Officer of Wellcome Trust, DBT India Line Chapter. Good evening, sir. We have come to know that the Wellcome Trust India Line Chapter was set up initially for 10 years, and we have come to know the fact that the funding for another 5 years have been sanctioned last year. Very congratulations to you, sir, on steering the ship of funds and hope for the Indian research fraternity, especially in the field of biomedical research. So we wanted to know what motivated you to take up the reins at Wellcome Trust, and what were the initial challenges that you faced in this regard?
So what personally motivated me to leave bench research and come here? Well, I had been doing bench research for about 30 years till then. And I felt that at that point in my life, I should do something different. But very honestly, I didn't feel that I had many exciting ideas for my own research. And I could have continued doing what I was doing for another 5 years. I had about 5 years left to retire from ICGB where I was. But looking back and assessing my own priorities, I realized that I was running short on ideas and therefore wanted to do something different. I had always enjoyed working with young people, so I thought this offered a much bigger canvas to do things. And you know, the trustees of India Alliance also thought that I would be capable of doing it. So they hired me and I changed track. Initial challenge, you know, those of us who do bench research in most Indian institutions pay very little attention to communicating your science to the lay audience. I was probably a little different. I was more inclined towards it than most of my colleagues. But that was one challenge which I faced here, because I had to project an entire organization and the work it did, and the fantastic work that our fellows did, to a large audience to justify the kind of funding that was being made to us. So that was a challenge. The other challenge, I think, was that I was and still am financially very incompetent. It was hard for me to read a balance sheet. It was hard for me to understand financial processes. So from that point of view, it's been a steep learning curve. But you know, new challenges are responsible for generating new nerve cells. So from that point of view, I've really enjoyed it.
So the next question is, do you think it is a good idea for funding organizations to mandate publication in open access publishing houses to the researchers they fund? We already had some discussion, but do you think they should mandate it?
Well, I think all funding agencies that use public money owe it to the public to do that. Now, as a principle, I think it should be done. But is the process available to you? Just by having the principle won't get you too far unless there is a process in place. And I think it is that process which was put together by DBT to begin with, and DST also subscribed to that, the open access policy. Unfortunately, it has not been enforced as much as it should have been. But I'm really hopeful that numbers will grow as more and more people feel the pressure of funding, feel the pressure of finding the money to publish an article, either page processing charges or open access charges. So it's inevitable. This movement will grow. The question is, are we going to lead it or are we going to be followers? And we have an opportunity to lead, and I prefer that India leads in this. We are the sixth largest producer of knowledge in the world now, and there is no reason why we should be conservative and not lead this.
Can there be a system put in place where a faculty should be judged? I mean, when they are up for promotion or anything, should they be judged if they are in support of this, all these things?
I wouldn't go that far to say that faculty should be judged on this metric. Look, as a principal, again, a researcher should have the choice. He or she should decide where they would publish their work. We try and publish our work in places where it is read by our peers, right? So we are the best judge. A researcher is the best judge of where to publish. I would not like to see a system where a funding agency or a government agency is telling researchers that you publish here, here, or here. That's not going to be a good situation. On the other hand, researchers need to be sensitized to the fact that they are using public money, and therefore the goals of their research, the results of their research, should be accessible to the public. And there are various models through which one could do that. So I wouldn't go to the extent of saying that people should be judged for making only open access publications, but they should feel responsible for doing it.
But perhaps, can't we make it mandate to make the preprints available free to the public?
Right.
And so whatever you publish, maybe it's in a Nature or Science journal, but can't you at least, can't we enforce that at least the preprint version, some version of the manuscript should be freely available to the public? So can that be made a mandate?
Right. So that's the whole idea of green open access. Green open access means that you've submitted a paper for publication to any journal XYZ. The paper gets accepted. You take the accepted version of the paper without the journal formatting, upload it in your institutional repository. That repository would be linked to servers which can take that information, and it becomes public.
Yeah, but then the concern with that, we are leaving it up to the individual universities or institutes,
right,
and they may not have the infrastructure. Can't we have a common platform? Let's say we have archive for most in physics. So can't you have a common platform where a researcher can upload the preprints?
Well, I mean, there are international archives. In biology now, there's bioarchive. In physics and mathematics, the archive has been there for a long time. Bioarchive is becoming hugely popular now with biologists. The question you should really be asking is, can a paper remain in the archive forever, or should it actually go through peer review and become, because when you load a paper in bioarchive, it doesn't go through peer review. The information is there, but it doesn't go through peer review. And now the interesting model that's coming up is, you submit a paper to, let's say, bioarchive. Regular mainstream journals would contact you to send that paper to their journal. So this is a reasonably good situation where you've made the data open access. It's available in the bioarchive. You then submit it to a regular journal. It goes through peer review and gets published. So the information becomes available. I think the point is that the information should be available.
And also you made a point that what do publishers really do? So in this case, suppose a paper is on archive, then you mentioned that it's not peer reviewed. And as a scientific society, do we want peer review? Yes, we do. Now, what is the next step? Why do we wait for publishers to take that initiative of peer review? Because peer review is done by scientists, by us.
Right.
So why can't we have a system in which there are some honorary editors or members who assign peer reviews, and it is all done by us? Why do you have to bring in a third party of publishers into this?
No, so that, you know, I started out by saying, asking this question, what do publishers do? And in fact, you're absolutely right. We write the papers, we do the peer review, we edit the journals. We're doing all of that. The publishers are providing an organizational platform. So yes, why can't universities do that? Why can't consortia come up and do that? So the Wellcome Open platform, for example, that I talked about, is a similar platform. You load a paper. After the initial checks to make sure that everything is according to the format, your paper goes live. Everyone can see it for free. Then it goes out for a peer review. The review comments are also loaded. Your rebuttal is loaded. So there's a whole thing available. And when you go to the site, you will see that if a paper is still under review, there will be a question mark on the right-hand corner. If a paper has already gone through peer review and has been accepted, then there are two tick marks. So yes, that platform is already there. Right now it's fairly small because it's only open to Wellcome funded researchers, but I see no reason why this momentum should not go forward. And you know,
Also, you had mentioned in one of your address available at India Alliance website that there's a dearth of senior researchers doing quality research.
Yes.
Why do you think so, and why do you think, what is the reason behind this?
So I have said that on our website, and that's largely in response to the kind of applications we get for our fellowships. So let me step back and say that we have three levels of fellowships: early career fellowship, intermediate fellowship, and senior fellowship. The early career fellowship and the intermediate fellowship have become extremely competitive. The senior fellowship, we get the quality of applications we get are very variable. And often we see that researchers who've been doing research in India for the last, let's say, 10-12 years, really have, you know, don't come up as very competitive. Now the question is, why is that happening? There could be multiple reasons for it. Easy funding available within the country. So therefore people are not really working at the cutting edge. See, for us, when I say competitive, it means that people should be working and writing at a level which is comparable to their colleagues in the West. And that's simply because all our fellowship applications get peer reviewed overseas. Most of them get reviewed outside India. We don't get them reviewed outside India because there are no good people in India to review. There are many good people in India who can do as good a job. The trouble is that our scientific enterprise in India, being fairly small, everyone is somebody's student, somebody's postdoc, somebody's collaborator's student, so there are too many conflicts of interest. And for that, that is one reason why we go outside for most of our peer review. And as a result of that, applications are judged at a level of a NIH grant or a European Commission grant. So the bar goes higher. And unfortunately, many of our so-called senior researchers, people who have spent 10, 12, 15 years doing research in India, have lost the ability to be competitive at that level. It's unfortunate, but it's true. So that's what I meant by saying that.
Okay. So there is often a case of gender imbalance in the scientific research community within the country. Do you think we need to worry much about it? And what role do organizations like WTIA play a role in to ensure equal participation?
Equal participation from?
From male and female.
Oh, gender. Okay. Well, the easy way to do that would be to say we will reserve 50% of our fellowships for women. That would be the easy way of doing it. But that would not be the right way of doing it. We as an organization stand for quality. Okay? Having said that, you should apply, instead of reservation, you should apply affirmative action. And there's a difference between the two. So, when, you know, women go and have a child, men don't, right? And usually at the, it happens at a stage when you've become, you're a postdoc or you're an assistant professor at that level. So you get pulled back because of domestic pressures. The way we handle this is, let's say our early career fellowship has an eligibility of 4 years, up to 4 years post PhD. If someone has gone, has taken a year off to raise a family, we take that 1 year off as a non-research career break. Now that's available to men also. It's not just available to women. Let's say a man, after finishing his PhD, goes to teach in a school where he has no way to do research, he can take that time off from the eligibility. So it's a fair system, but it's used effectively for women who are active in research and who want to pursue a career in research. The second way we do this for women is, once we have chosen a fellow, and this is a 5-year fellowship grant, she goes on maternity leave. The prescribed maternity leave according to Government of India is 26 weeks. Your institution will give you time off for 26 weeks and not a day more than that for maternity leave. We say that even though she comes back after 26 weeks, she is not mentally or physically ready to work at this, at a high level. So therefore we give a 1 year full cost extension to the fellowship. So in effect, a 5-year fellowship becomes a 6-year fellowship. This is one way of ensuring that even though you have gone and had a child, raised a family, you are still competitive moving on to the next level. So we try to level the playing field, so to say. That's our way of doing it. And I wish more Indian funding agencies did that, honestly. I wish more institutions that did that, increase the time to tenure for young women faculty, provided them services at the site where they work, a child care facility, and you know, a daycare room, things like that go a long way in assuring women that they are valued at their place of work.
Do you think we can solve the problem of gender imbalance in STEM at the higher education level? Or is the real problem is that like in class 10th and 12th, many people are not opting for science, many women are not opting for science. So is that the problem really there, or can we just solve it at the...
No, you're absolutely right. I mean, the problem is far more deep-rooted. The problem is a social problem, it's a cultural problem. If you're a girl, you should study biology and not physics or mathematics. You know, those stereotypes are built very early. All I'm saying is, at the what we can do, we are doing. We are unable to solve the problem at the school level and at the family level, and we can't even attempt to do that. But we really try to take care of that odd, strong young woman who comes up to that level and competes. All we can do is to give her a fair chance, and that's what we're doing. But yes, the problem is very deep rooted.
Also, due to that, that also provides role models for the young people.
Absolutely. Role models are critical. Yes, absolutely. I mean, when you go to conferences, how many speakers are women? I was reading somewhere recently that women ask fewer questions at conferences. Why? Because there are no role models. They hesitate, you know. So I think role models are very important, absolutely.
I have a just off the track question. So we are aware of your blogging experiences, and we were very interested and intrigued by the name of it, Cold Stones in Hot Zones. Does the name refer to something?
Yeah. I wish I had more time to write my blog. I just don't get time to do it anymore. The name Cold Stones and Hot Zones came from two of my interests. One is history and historical monuments. That's the cold stones. And hot zones is infectious disease, viruses. So, I mean, initially, if you've read my blog, I used to write regularly on, you know, like travel blogs, write a lot about history of places and their architecture and all that. And I've also written about Spanish flu and, you know, HIV and Ebola, you know, all kinds of infectious disease. So yeah, that's where the name comes from.
Okay. So of late and even previously, we have witnessed cases of the same research work being published in two separate journals, indicating the dismal level of scrutiny adhered to by the respective publishing houses. Where do you think lies the accountability of the publishing houses, and who are they answerable to?
Well, publishing houses in the current model of publishing really rely on referees and editors. Now, actually, it's fairly easy to check. Every paper should go through the plagiarism software. And if it does, you know, it's caught very easily. Publishers do a responsibility, absolutely. They are providing the platform. They are charging paid charges or pay to publish charges, whatever they may be. So, and they are charging, they're putting their journals behind paywalls so that they're charging people to read them. So yes, the responsibility lies absolutely with them that the content that they are publishing has not been published elsewhere. Having said that, responsibility also lies with us researchers, people who are putting that work out, copying somebody else's work, putting it out, editors who are supposed to be experts in the area but are not picking it, and the pressures that institutions and systems create on people to publish a certain number of papers. It's that which is creating this problem.
No, but who are they answerable to? The question is, I mean, we have seen a recent paper that has been published in Nature, already again picked up by an elsewhere, elsewhere publishers. So the point is, I mean, we never get to know that whether they have been sued, what are the measures they have taken down that, that paper from their website now, but what measures have been taken, we don't get to know about it. So how do we,
unfortunately,
there's no platform for that. I have a copy of this also.
Unfortunately, they get around by saying that we get what people submit to us. So if somebody is stealing and submitting to us, the responsibility lies on the person who's submitting and not on us. But I don't think that's the whole story. If publishers are making money from it, they're equally responsible for it. I mean, if I'm selling adulterated goods in my shop, I can't get away by saying that, you know, it came from a factory. So only the factory is responsible for it. I am also responsible for selling things beyond the expiry date. So it's the same.
Measures have been taken by government until now for this.
Well, government cannot do everything. Government can provide. Scientific community needs to do that. Scientific community needs to shame people who do this. Scientific community needs to find ways of reprimanding people for doing it. Unfortunately, the scientific community itself is not very honest in doing these things, and it tries to cover up many times. So yes, the problem does lie with us. Absolutely.
And you mentioned what publishers do. This should have been one of the things that they would have claimed to do.
Yeah. They claim to do that, yeah. But they don't do that.
Hmm.
Yeah. Now, following up, now this is the age of fake news, and also we have been witnessing fake science. Now, when you talk about science has basically two parts. One is the methodology, and the other is the facts that come out of it. Now, presenting facts, the way it has been presented, there's a lot of pseudo-scientific things that have been coming up, mainly social media and all. But in India, the situation is slightly worse because it's the mainstream, we can call them politician, or there's a mainstream thing selling those pseudo-scientific thoughts. Now, how does this affect the public perception of science in India, and even the perception of the world about India as well?
Well, public perception of science in India, I would say, scientists themselves are seen in very good light in India. I mean, scientists are respected. You tell anybody that, you're doing a PhD, you're a scientist, they give you a lot of respect. So the onus is really upon us to justify that respect. Pseudoscience, some of it is ridiculous, absurd, hilarious. You can just have a good laugh and move on. And I think most of us do that. The world does that. Let's not start taking these people too seriously. I think this is something that has happened in all times. It will continue to happen. The question that we should really be worried about is, as a practicing scientist, am I following the scientific method? It's very easy to blame somebody else for the pseudoscience. If I'm doing what I see is real science, am I following the right scientific method? Am I following the right scientific ethic? I think at our level, if each of us does that, let's not worry too much about that pseudoscience. Don't take it too seriously, laugh it off.
Yeah, we would have easily, but then the concern is those who do that, some of them at least are in power to make policy that affects science. I mean, they could be chief minister, ministers of higher education, etc. So when such stuff is coming from them, is it easy enough to say, just laugh it off, ignore it?
A lot of that, I feel, is to grab attention. Okay. Be assured that the government is advised on science by very competent people. Okay? All that really is an aberration to really catch attention, to make news. Okay. Yeah. When you see a news, the important question to ask is, what is that news trying to hide, instead of what that news is trying to show? Most news is put out to divert your attention from something else. As scientists, you should really be looking at that instead of worrying about the funny stuff.
Okay. So, are you aware of any bias against non-English speaking nations with respect to the way their research is perceived by the world scientific community?
Since most science is in English, most science publications are in English, instead of bias, I would say there would be ignorance of science that is published in other languages. How much science have we read that is published in Russian or Chinese? So I would say, instead of calling it bias, I would say it is really lack of our own understanding of it. And yes, if we don't understand something, we tend to be biased against it. It's natural human tendency. So I don't think we should worry too much about this and get into projecting ourselves as victims of anything like
what
that.
What I meant is that a research publication from India would be viewed with a lot more skepticism than the research.
But Indians publish in English. Most Indian research is published in English. So language doesn't really.
No.
You mean region?
Yes.
That happens. I mean, earlier this was mentioned, Harvard-Hyderabad syndrome. The same research, if it's sent from a Western location versus an Eastern location. Yes, it is looked at differently. But, I think over the years, Indian scientists have made a place for themselves. There is a respect in the world scientific community. Of course, there are aberrations. There would be that odd person out who would send a plagiarized paper. But that happens everywhere. I mean, the biggest case of scientific misconduct happened at Bell Labs. So, that can happen at the best of places.
So now, it is close to 90 years since the Nobel Prize in Sciences was bagged by an Indian, Sir C.V. Raman, in 1930. So with the kind of science flourishing in the country in the present scenario, can we be optimistic to get one of the Nobel Prizes in the near future, more so in the domain of physiology and medicine?
That's a wrong question to ask, when India would get a Nobel Prize. Let me explain it with an analogy. Mount Everest is the highest peak in the world. Does it stand in isolation? It doesn't. It is part of a range of mountains which is called the Himalayas. So instead of asking when India would get the Nobel Prize, I think we should be focused on building that range of mountains. You build the range, peaks will emerge. Don't worry about the peaks. The Nobel Prize, many people would argue it's political, this, that. But at the end of the day, it does award very significant pieces of work. There's no denying that. So let's not worry about when the next Nobel Prize will be made based on a discovery in India. Rather, let's worry about broadening the excellence of science in the country. If we have a large number of institutions that are doing world-class science, I'm sure a Nobel Prize will also come to India someday. But let's not ask that question.
So regarding doing world-class science and regarding doing, let's say, big science, now there are science in which it's an incremental development of something, and there are science which are trying to solve a new problem where there is hardly, we don't know how it will go in the future, or we don't know the probability of success of it. Now, the current educational infrastructure in which there is, let's say, a five-year PhD program within he has to finish the research and go. And also, even if you become a postdoctoral or young faculty, you have to have a funding grant and you have to submit reports that what you have done with that grant. Now, isn't that infrastructure putting pressure, saying that you have to submit results, quote-unquote, you have to do research which are not aiming big and which are very more secured rather than taking risk? So isn't that the scenario?
No, absolutely, you're right. I mean, most people are doing safe science, and most people are doing safe science because their careers depend on that next paper, that next grant. So as a result, the ability to take risk the ability to fail is not there. And I, that's why, you know, I have been an advocate of long-term funding to people and institutions. You know, currently, the funding cycle of a government grant is 3 years. And the size of an average government grant is such that if you're running a really internationally competitive lab, you need at least 3-4 grants at the same time, which means that the principal investigator is always writing a grant. So if he's always writing a grant, when is he thinking about the problem? When is he finding time to mentor students? And so the risk-taking ability is lost if you survive on these 3-year funding models. So therefore, once you've established your credentials as somebody who can do good work, there has to be a scheme that will fund risky research with fairly, you know, long-term funding. Without that, it won't happen. We will continue to do incremental research.
But till you establish your credentials, are you not in a part of a system that you're used to do safe science?
Look, I see what you're saying, but would you invest money into somebody who has not proven themselves?
You know, funding can be allocated based on ideas and what they're planning to do, and the method itself should be treated as a success rather than the outcome.
But ideas have to be executed.
Yes.
So open up the ideas, and the younger, you know, let young people come up with ideas. And I believe the government has a program like that where, you know, they're going to schools, they're going to colleges and seeking ideas. Definitely open up the ideas. But, you know, the ideas have to then be investigated. There has to be a process to it. And you have to be trained in the process to follow it. So, you know, you do need some credentials before money is going to be invested in you. So, yes, we need to go to a model where we fund both long-term high-risk research as a, along with medium-term research, which, you know, produces papers, which produces incremental increments. You know, all of those things are required. Saying you either do this or that never works. It has to be a good mix. And at the base of it is the fact that we have a fairly small scientific enterprise. I mean, I'm told that the number of biologists in India is smaller than the number of biologists in Boston or in the San Francisco Bay Area. So it's a matter of numbers also. The critical mass. I mean, in any given area in India, I can tell for biology, I mean, the virus I worked on, there were like 2-3 people in India who worked on that virus. Now, if I write a grant, it goes to those people. If they write a grant, it comes to me. So, you know, it's not a big enough scientific enterprise in any given area. And that is something we need to expand. If we expand that, then let's not worry about Nobel Prizes, innovation, this, that. It'll happen on its own.
So we came across your article in Nature India on Indian universities. There you mentioned about the importance of more autonomy to the institutions. So can you elaborate on the idea?
You mean more money to institutions or?
Making more autonomous.
Oh, autonomy. Okay. No, absolutely. I think the whole higher education system in India is over-regulated. Institutions need more autonomy to govern themselves, to find their own leadership, to decide what courses they should be running. a lot of those things. Unfortunately, the system is too over-regulated. The government right now has made some right noises, but a lot of people also think that in the guise of giving more autonomy, the government is actually trying to cut funding. There is that thought also. So I think autonomy is critical. Autonomy must be given, because only academics, researchers are the best judges of how to do things in higher education.
So you mentioned earlier that you moved into sort of research administration by leaving your job. So how difficult it is to maintain two things together? Do you think that the time has come for research graduates like many of us to think about careers in research management?
No, absolutely. See, I moved into research management fairly late in my career. I led a group, did research for 25 years before I moved into research administration. I was never trained in research administration. Now there are opportunities for people to be trained in research management. And this should be seen as an attractive, career. But I would also caution that don't get into research management because doing research is difficult. Don't run away from research into research management. Do research management if you're passionate about doing it. And that goes about everything in life. Don't do something just because you're attracted to the glamour of it or because somebody else told you to do it. Do it because you want to do it. And if you do that, that's perfect. You get paid for having fun. There's nothing like that.
And so one last question related to the discussion we had. How does making these repositories in India, the problem of subscription doesn't solve. We ultimately, because we cannot just cut ourselves off from the research that is going on in worldwide. So how does this support, what are your views on this?
Well, repository alone, institutional repositories alone would not do it. This is a gradual process. We start putting papers in repositories, those papers become more accessible to everyone else around the world. We read their papers, they read our papers, information gets exchanged, we get new ideas to do research.
We'll still have to get subscriptions to these.
Yes, in the current model, yes, but I think that model itself is changing. That model itself is under pressure. And you will see that there would be more open access and these models would change.
So you're saying that publishers will stop charging us ultimately?
They would find other ways of making money.
So we are very thankful to you for your time and patience. Finally, we would like to ask you, when do we get to read the next post on your blog? Because it is almost a year now.
I know. It's been more than a year. I don't know.
It came in October 2017.
Yeah, I don't know. I wish I had a little more time to do it, but I've gone away from blog to writing pieces in newspapers, and so I feel that's also important because that gives you a wider audience. But yeah, but writing a blog, you don't have to go back and correct it. You can just write what you think at that time. So I miss that, but maybe soon.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.